humble and riding on a donkey, acclaimed by crowds and caroled by children. We greet
you,
moving from the peace of the countryside to the corridors of power. Beasts of burden a new dignity. You are giving majesty a new face.
One day soon, they will ask what
this means as he enters the city on a donkey for peace. Neither brought by a war horse nor by his feet, on a path strewn with cloaks, with palm leaves beneath. And the chaos he causes is a seismic event. There's no need to make speeches when you're heaven sent. And the leaders and rulers on the walls, half bent, look down at this man in triumphal lament. He wept for the city, and now that he's near, he rides without speaking. And still the crowd cheer, clamoring loudly through danger and fear. The prophet called Jesus is here. He is here. His presence is preaching. But no one can know the reason he's come or the way that he'll go. And today, he just rides, gentle and slow, down the road, through the gates, over the palm leaves. And so, when they look at this day, beginning to see the ways he fulfills each of these prophecies, they'll notice a quietness beyond all belief. God claiming this kingdom without having to speak.
Yeah!
A reading from the Gospel according to John. A little while, and you will no longer see me. And again a little while, and you will see me. Then some of his disciples said to one another, "What does he mean by saying to us, 'A little while, and you will no longer see me, and again a little while, and you will see me, and because I am going to the Father?'" They said, "What does he mean by this, 'a little while'? We do not know what he is talking about." Jesus knew that they wanted to ask him, so he said to them, "Are you discussing among yourselves what I meant when I said, 'A little while and you will no longer see me, and again a little while and you will see me'? Very truly I tell you, you will weep and mourn, and the world will rejoice. You will have pain, but your pain will turn into joy." When a woman is in labor, she has pain because her hour has come. But when her child is born, she no longer remembers the anguish because of the joy of having brought a human being into the world. So you have your pain now, but I will see you again, and your hearts will rejoice, and no one will take your joy from you. On that day, you will ask nothing of me. Very truly, I tell you, if you ask anything of the Father in my name, he will give it to you." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be now and always acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Today, as you know, appears in our calendar as a sort of Janus day, both Palm Sunday and Passion Sunday. It's a day which highlights the expectations which many people held of Jesus as the Messiah, a potential political, even a military leader. The day also looks forward to his arrest, passion, and death. These two strands are delicately intertwined throughout our service this evening, more subtly than in this morning's liturgy, perhaps, but with striking effect. I've always found my attention focused on the role which the onlookers play in these two segments of the gospel narrative. The crowd in the palm procession hails Jesus as the one who comes in the name of the Lord and shouts Hosanna, which in Hebrew means save us, but which seems already in the Gospels to be moving towards its later sense of honor and praise. After Jesus' arrest, the crowd is very much the mouthpiece of Jesus' enemies. They shout, "Crucify him," and turn the language of praise into mockery. Every year we speak and sing these words, and it makes us think more deeply, at least I hope it does, about what happens in crowds. Perhaps these were two completely different groups of people, as some have suggested. But I think it's likelier that what we're seeing is roughly the same group of random Jerusalem bystanders, unthinkingly picking up the mood and intention of those around them, and shifting in the space of a few days from Hosanna to Crucify. Unthinkingly is perhaps the key word here. The satiric comic novelist Terry Pratchett had some pointed and insightful things to say on the subject. Always remember that the crowd that applauds your coronation is the same crowd that will applaud your beheading. People like a show. And the intelligence of that creature known as a crowd is the square root of the number of people in it. We have plenty of examples in the current affairs of our own day of just how problematic mob psychology can be. Large gatherings, of course, can begin and end meaningfully with a clear focus throughout, but others can amplify ignorance, hatred, and violence. A crowd which begins in peaceful support of a people or a group or a principle can very easily be shifted toward toxic nationalism or intolerance or destruction, because the metabolism of a crowd depends on things like simple chants and spontaneous collective movement, things which encourage the suspension of individual judgment and the surrender of will. And as we know, a very similar phenomenon can be seen in social media, although the mechanisms are newer and somewhat different. Crowds can be manipulated, and they can also be used to manipulate those who are more powerful, but whose power depends on a constant negotiation of appeasement and force. Those like Pilate and Herod. Our hymns, our second reading, and our cantata, though, show us very different kinds of surrender of will. The self-emptying of the incarnate word, and the response of gratitude and humility in the faithful soul. There is an enormous difference between mindless acquiescence in the shouting of a mob, whether that shouting is for good or ill, Hosanna or Crucify. A difference between that and submission to the will of God, prayerfully discerned. The first is an abandonment of responsibility and judgment, hiding behind the dynamic of the multitude, while the second is about openness to the God who knows us intimately and calls us each by name. Obedience to the promptings of God, however individual it must be, is not individualistic. We too are called to serve rather than to be served, to undercut the whole worldly enterprise of advantage and greed by our subversive acts of love and care and offering. There will be many times when we, like those first disciples, fall short of this commandment, but the love of God is constant, boundless, and unfailing, summoning us back into relationship with God and with one another, into discernment and service and praise. It calls to us in the darkness of death and despair and in the brightness of resurrection. As we walk this week the way of the cross, let our hearts and minds be attentive to the voice that calls us and resonate with the solemn music of love. In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you. Gracious God,
the suffering and death of Jesus, your only Son, makes us pleasing in your sight. Alone we can do nothing, but through his sacrifice may we receive your love and mercy. Amen.
Let us pray. Because you, God, love the world, because in Christ you walked it, we dare to pray. God, send your Spirit. To connect the words of ancient scripture to the life of the world today, to let the urgent summons of Jesus surpass our reticence to respond, God, send your Spirit. To awaken the minds of those in power to the realities of those they govern, to confront the arrogance of the privileged with the vulnerability of the poor, God, send your Spirit. To engage the fragile state of the planet with those who carelessly abuse it, to let the pain of those who are hurting awaken the caring potential of the healthy, God, send your Spirit. To eradicate the distance between our convictions and our commitments, our potentials and our performance, our prayers and our politics, our faith and our discipleship, God, send your Spirit. To hold before God in confidence the ones for whom we weep, and the ones who, in joy or sorrow, weep for us, the ones who reveal in themselves what is hidden, and the ones who treat as precious all we confide in them, the ones who, today, we want to pray for, and the ones who, unasked, today will pray for us. God, send your Spirit. Convince us, gracious God, that all is up for redemption, and since in Jesus you destined all to be changed and made new, enable us to be agents for your purpose. We pray in Jesus' name.
God of creation, whose only Son absorbed the violence and cruelty of this world, and by his compassion transformed it into love, grant us the grace in our sufferings to share in his passion, and in our joys to share in his resurrection, that grafted into him, we may be inheritors of a life that is free, that is true, and that is holy.